Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Today, to lower your blood pressure, the London School of Economics says you just have to do one important thing, and it's as good as medication. Well, medication has some very serious effects. Yeah, it'll lower your blood pressure, but it can cause erectile dysfunction. It can cause all forms of energy imbalances. It affects the mitochondria. What is this natural, non-toxic process? We'll discuss it. I hope you had a chance yesterday to listen to a one-hour special, Bringing in the New Year, with Danny Sheehan, part of our Conversations with Remarkable Mind series, where we laid out a spiritual and progressive manifesto, understanding the historical nature of how we got to where we're at and what we need to do to become more socially active. We will be following up on that. Later this week, we will present on PRN.fm a letter to all the people, the 100 million plus independents who want to have a better world but don't know how to go about it. We'll show you all the different progressive ideals that benefit everyone. No one is excluded. And that's how anything should be versus what we have today, which is so grounded in animosity towards the other of a class, a race, an orientation. And it shouldn't be that way. So that's what we've got coming. Today, we're going to have the first of our The People Talk Back. This is something you have not heard. We wanted to have a person who went before Congress instead of taking the Fifth Amendment and being excoriated for political gain so people can say, we really went after those bad people. This is reversed. This is a person that challenges Congress and does so in an articulate and an uncompromising way. You haven't heard this before. You'll hear it today. So I think you'll find it revealing. That's our show. No guests today. We'll get back to guests on tomorrow's program. Well, for people with high blood pressure, starting an exercise regimen can lower blood pressure by as much as taking medications. Researchers combined data from nearly 400 randomized trials that assess the effect of blood pressure drugs or of exercise on blood pressure. They found that overall, each lowered blood pressure about the same in people with hypertension. But exercise created the reductions in systolic blood pressure, as commonly as an antihypertensive drug, but without any of the harmful side effects. So once again, good science shows that natural non-toxic therapies that we could apply daily can keep us healthy and reverse conditions or improve conditions that otherwise we'd be relying upon a drug to do. So that's a good review. And this was published in the British Journal of Sports Medicine. From the University of Texas, MD Anderson Cancer Center, comes an article published in Cancer Research showing that sugar in the Western diets increases the risk of breast cancer, tumors, and metastasis. I wished I would have had this study when I debated Dr. Elizabeth Whalen of the American Council on Science and Health, a very pro-industry, pro-big pharma, pro-big sugar company. I wished I would have had this particular study when Sharon Rockefeller, who was president of the PBS local station board in Washington and a member without any of us knowing, she sat on the board of directors of Pepsi Cola that uses a lot of sugar and then put pressure coming from the Sugar Association not to have me back after I had had eight record-breaking appearances with eight different programs on PBS in Washington. And by the way, if you want to see a excoriating rebuttal to her and that was sent to every member of the PBS National Board, to the local board, to the Sugar Institute, to the Washington Post, and guess what? Not a single response. We took every point they made and completely destroyed it. But that's the basis of power. Power seems unaccountable to its actions. In any case, the high amount of dietary sugar in the typical Western diet increases the risk of breast cancer, metastasis to the lungs, according to this study from the University of Texas MD Anderson Cancer Center. And the findings demonstrate dietary sugar's effect on an enzymatic signaling pathway known as 12-LOX, which stands for LOX's lipoxygenase. Quote, "We found that sucrose," that's your white sugar, "intake in mice comparable to levels in the Western diets led to increased tumor growth and metastasis when compared to non-sugar starch diet," end quote. And that was from Dr. Yang, the assistant professor in rehabilitation integrative medicine. So, now we have just another study. That's not the first study. That's just an additional study showing sugar and breast cancer. But let's see what the American Cancer Society, the National Cancer Institute, has to say about that. I remember once I contacted the director of the National Cancer Institute, and we had a long conversation. And he was a very, very open person. And he readily admitted that during the 1950s, and 60s, there was a great deal of research at the National Cancer Institute using vitamin D, retinoic acid, vitamin A, vitamin C, and selenium, etc., showing its impact upon cancer. And these were very positive outcomes. However, pressure, political pressure from the pharmaceutical industry to not conflate two separate issues. The natural non-toxic approach to cancer, which one of its scientists was very strong about, Dr. Dean Burke, one of the founders of the National Cancer Institute, who I knew very well, and chemotherapy. You could not use both. You had to use one or the other, and therefore, politically, I was told by the director of the National Cancer Institute that there was enormous political pressure to go only with the toxic chemotherapy. So you have no idea how much pressure is behind the scenes to keep good information from getting to the public. From the United Arab University, Emirates University, and this was published in Recent Patients in Anti-Cancer Drug Discovery, that saffron, remember I mentioned saffron was very good a couple of days ago? Well, another study shows that saffron-based crocin, C-R-O-C-I-N, prevents liver cancer. And liver cancer remains among the leading causes of cancer-related deaths worldwide. And this new study showed that saffron and one of its elements, crocin, protects against liver cancer. So one more reason when you're making some brown rice or quinoa, put in some saffron. That's what they do in India and other Middle Eastern and Far Eastern countries. Saffron is very common there, very rare in the United States. In fact, some stores don't even carry it. But if you can get it and get it online and get it in larger amounts, you'll save money. Taking vitamin D can benefit people with multiple sclerosis. Who says? Johns Hopkins University says. Where was it published? Neurology, the official journal of the American Academy of Neurology. One of my closest friends for nearly 50 years was Dr. Martin Feldman. We did many studies together, over 43 clinical studies with humans. And he used to come up every single night at the Institute of Applied Biology and sit there while I was doing my laboratory work. And he was a consummate nerd. A fun evening for Marty was sitting reading scientific journals, literally. I mean, that's what. In fact, once I brought him up to the Fertiller Farm, and there he is in a hammock by the lake, beautiful day, and I walk over, and there's a whole shopping bag, and it's all filled with scientific articles. That's what Marty liked to do. And by the way, he was very quiet. He rarely spoke out. But he graduated number one at Yale University, and then he was top of his class at Columbia University College of Physicians and Surgeons. He was professor up at Mount Sinai in neurology, published over 68 scientific papers in the scientific literature. And what was interesting, he would come over and sit quietly on the couch in my office, and with the person's permission, I said, "This is Dr. Martin Feldman. He's just monitoring what I'm doing. Is that all right?" And they say, "Fine." And he would then see how I approached the subject of health, helping people. In any case, he said, "Gary, when I give up drugs," which he did, he never offered drugs after that in his decades upon decade of helping people, and he helped a lot of people. He said, "I guess I also have to give up publishing in peer-reviewed literature." Well, not true. Almost all the studies we did were published in peer-reviewed literature, and he was invited with me to go to scientific conferences to present our information. So there is a body of very interested scientists and physicians wanting to know what to do, and multiple sclerosis is high up on their list. So I remember presenting that coenzyme Q10 at 3,000 milligrams a day of ubiquinol can make a difference. And there was this like silence, like, "What do you mean that high?" I said, "This isn't for the average person. They would be fine with 100 milligrams. But you're talking about what ubiquinol does inside the cell, and you need a real uptick, and you have to have three nutrients all together and to get that mitochondria clicking again so that there is energy in the central nervous system and energy in the brain and the neurons for the benefit of the multiple sclerosis person." I don't know how many people took that advice, but now John Hopkins is telling us that taking a high dose of vitamin D3 is safe for people with multiple sclerosis and can help regulate the body's hyperactive immune response. That's important. Quote, "These results are exciting, as vitamin D has the potential to be an inexpensive, safe, and convenient treatment for people with multiple sclerosis." End quote. That is Peter Calabresi, MD, director of John Hopkins Multiple Sclerosis Center and professor of neurology at the John Hopkins University School of Medicine. Okay. Did you see this in any of the media? Surely with millions of people suffering from multiple sclerosis, this should have made some cover stories. It should have been mentioned. Not a word. It's in the literature, as are hundreds of thousands of other studies that are positive, but nothing leaks down into the mainstream media. And there's a good reason for that. Lemongrass, by the way, lemongrass tea, iced tea, is just terrific. And you can get your lemongrass, ideally at the long threads of lemongrass, and you soak them overnight, and then you boil them for a few minutes, doesn't take long, and then add in pure lemon juice and a teaspoon of manuka honey and a couple twigs of fresh mint. Then put in some ice. That gives you a delicious lemongrass tea. Here's what the University of Yua and Calabar, both are in Nigeria. Here's what it says, and this was published in the Journal of Medicinal Food. Lemongrass boosts the production of red blood cells to treat anemia. So, people with anemia can find that drinking lemongrass tea is beneficial to them. I'm sure many people in this audience know that anemia is a condition in which the level of healthy red blood cells in the body becomes too low. And that can potentially harm health because red blood cells contain hemoglobin, and hemoglobin transports oxygen to the body's tissues. And it can cause health complications such as fatigue and stress on the body's organs. So this study showed that lemongrass, and they used the lemongrass leaf powder. What's in it? Well, tannins, saponins, alkaloids, flavonoids, macronutrients, micronutrients. So all these become an infusion when it's in powder form, meaning it you can blend it in such a way that it all disperses, and then you get a higher bioavailability, meaning more of it will actually get into your cells. And that greatly increases the packed cell volume, which is the percentage of red blood cells found in the blood. And lemongrass leaf infusion also significantly increases hemoglobin and red blood cell levels. So that indicates that the infusion prepared from lemongrass boosts the body's ability to produce red blood cells, which may be attributable to the extract's antioxidant effect. So that's good. Also, from the University of Pennsylvania, an article published in the New England Journal of Medicine talks about why people can no longer ignore the potent way to transform your health. And what this study showed was that the people that you surround yourself with in your relationships or your friends or your family can directly impact your health choices, which in turn creates either healthy habits and behaviors or unhealthy ones. So the question is, who is more likely to be around when you are deciding what to eat or whether to watch TV or to take a walk? It's not your doctor. It's your spouse or your partner or a relative or a friend. So you're not going to have a nurse navigator. You're going to have people who are in your life, and those people will directly impact your choices because you don't want to alienate them. In fact, I even had this conversation where I make some lunches for the staff, but I have to always also assume that my staff, if they're interested in health, they will say, "Gary, can I try one of those veggie burgers? Or can I try that soup, that fresh tomato corn chowder you just made? Or one of the other entrees that I make?" But if they don't want that, I'm not there to be their guardian nor their accuser. In fact, I made a comment that in all my years of friendships, clear back to my hometown friends that I grew up with, never once did I talk about diet with them. Not once. When we went out and ate, I'd eat my baked potato or broccoli, whatever I could, and they'd eat their steak or chicken, whatever they wanted. And the reason that we were there having that meal was not so we could debate or discuss our dietary intake, but to share the joy and beauty of a friendship. And these are people that didn't take themselves seriously. They could laugh at themselves, they could laugh at life and each other. Today, you have to be very conscious, if you're in the public, of what you say, because someone is always offended by everything. And so we're not there to preach. Remember, those of us who have chosen a vegan lifestyle, Mother Teresa was not a vegan. That did not mean she was not a compassionate person who helped a lot of people in India who were suffering. She was not a perfect person. She had her flaws. We are imperfect. Everyone has flaws. But do we learn from our lessons? One of them is acceptance of the other person. If they say, "I'm not going to change, this is what I want to eat, Gary," I'm not there to debate them and argue, because then the energy changes from having a friend and sharing that friendship and the joys of friendship to being there as a Mr. Cratchit. I'm not there to discipline or reprimand anyone. And if you want to live a lonely life, be hypercritical of the people in your life. Find fault in them because they're not as pure as yourself. And you win. You're going to look each day, and it's going to look like every other day, and the one thing missing out of that day are going to be people. Because nobody wants to be around self-righteous, insensitive, and hypercritical of everyone else's limitations, especially about food. So I remember when I was, the one group I tried to influence was my family, and that didn't work, but that didn't mean they were not good people, filled with love and happiness and joy and acceptance. So for those of you who say, I can't find anyone to befriend because they're not vegan, well, friend, then you're looking for the wrong type of friends. And maybe you're the wrong friend. Occupational asthma sufferers may need more vitamin D. This is the University of Medicine and Pharmacy in Romania. And this was published in a recent issue of Endocrine, Metabolic, and Immune Disorders, Drug Targets. And it talked about people with occupational asthma have a need for a greater intake of vitamin D. Now, what do I mean? Occupational asthma. Asthma related to job exposure is a common occurrence and can continue even after the sufferer is no longer exposed to the conditions that triggered the disease. So, if you work in a place that has got toxic air, those chemicals are coming into your body and that can create an asthmatic reaction, then you may need more vitamin D. Also from Madrid Institute for Advanced Studies in Food, which is in Spain, they found a new cancer remedy, and it was in yarrow, Y-A-R-R-O-W, as well as marigold, M-A-R-R-M-A-R-I-G-O-L-D, marigold. And both are cousins of the Asteraceae family of plants, and they have natural chemicals that treat pancreatic cancer. And this was a major study. So extracts of the common marigold and yarrow could slow down, even stop the growth of cancer cells. Now, pancreatic cancer is the fifth deadliest cancer around the world, and over 70,000 deaths each year. And in its early stages, the disease is treated through surgery. And as pancreatic cancer progresses, it is very difficult in traditional medicine to work with. They use 5-fluorouracil and a nab-paclitaxel, and they are not very effective. Now, there are many plants that contain compounds that display anti-cancer activity, and they affect the molecular pathways involved in the development and progression of the tumor. Their different approaches lets them kill cancer cells without harming healthy cells. Now there's marjoram, lemon balm. Now add yarrow and marigold, and of course the best of all would be black cumin. And in addition to that would be turmeric in its most potent form, curcumin. So, again, good studies being done. And finally, from Kaiser Permanente Division of Research, they found disturbing evidence that's suggesting that Wi-Fi radiation could increase the risk of miscarriages by almost 50%. I'm going to be doing a full hour on the new Wi-Fi towers and the radiation it's creating and what it'll do to bees and birds' navigational systems and humans with pre-existing conditions and how common they are and where they're at. That'll be a one-hour special coming up. But modern society is simply drunk on technology. It's around us everywhere we go, from the computers and tablets and laptops we use for work to the smartphones we carry around and the movies we stream via Wi-Fi. So for many people, it would be difficult to picture making it through 24 hours without using some form of wireless technology. And while these devices provide some convenience, absolutely, and connectivity, they should have big, fat warning labels on them, because the EMF, electromagnetic frequency radiation they transmit, has been recognized as a class 2B possible carcinogen, meaning cancer causer, by the World Health Organization and more studies have proven conclusively that these devices cause serious health problems. And of course, children are even more vulnerable to the effects of this type of radiation than adults, and unborn children are the most vulnerable of all. So the study conducted by researchers from the Kaiser Permanente Division of Research, which was published in the Journal of Scientific Reports, found that when pregnant women are exposed to non-ionizing radiation from magnetic fields, such as that emanated from power lines or transformers or wireless devices and wireless networks, their risk of miscarriage increases by a staggering 48%. So, there you have the latest on health and healing. I'm Gary Null, and tomorrow I'm going to talk about turmeric's smart kill properties. They put radiation and chemotherapy to shame. So that is on tomorrow. We're going to take a brief break, and when we come back, we're going to go directly into a Senate hearing. And I'll just give you a little background where George Galloway, this Scotsman who lives in Ireland and or lives in the United Kingdom and or in both places, and was a member of Parliament, and he was accused of receiving tens of millions of dollars in some shady food for oil deal, or oil for food. And the people that he's addressing, including the chairman of the committee, were the people who actually did the accusing. Now, it's protocol to act with some form of temperance at these hearings. And he doesn't believe in those rules. He just believes in getting to the truth. Now, mind you, at any time, this whole panel could have stopped him and challenged him and called him to order. Listen to the response. This is one of the shows I want to open the new year with to show you what we need more of in our society. So back in a moment and going right into that.
Subcommittee are required to be sworn. This time I'm going to ask you to rise and please raise your right hand.
You swear the testimony you're about to give before the subcommittee is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
We will be using a timing system today, Mr. Galloway. We could have 10 minutes for opening statement. If you need more time, we'll certainly accommodate that, and you may proceed.
Senator, I am not now, nor have I ever been, an oil trader, and neither has anyone on my behalf. I have never seen a barrel of oil, owned one, bought one, sold one, and neither has anybody on my behalf. Now, I know that standards have slipped over the last few years in Washington, but for a lawyer, you're remarkably cavalier with any idea of justice. I'm here today, but last week, you already found me guilty. You traduced my name around the world without ever having asked me a single question, without ever having contacted me, without ever having written to me or telephoned me, without any contact with me whatsoever. And you call that justice. Now, I want to deal with the pages that relate to me in this dossier, and I want to point out areas where there are, let's be charitable and say, errors. And then I want to put this in the context that I believe it ought to be. On the very first page of your document about me, you assert that I have had many meetings with Saddam Hussein. This is false. I have had two meetings with Saddam Hussein, once in 1994 and once in August of 2002. By no stretch of the English language can that be described as many meetings with Saddam Hussein. As a matter of fact, I've met Saddam Hussein exactly the same number of times as Donald Rumsfeld met him. The difference is, Donald Rumsfeld met him to sell him guns and to give him maps, the better to target those guns. I met him to try and bring about an end to sanctions, suffering, and war, and on the second of the two occasions, I met him to try and persuade him to allow Dr. Hans Blix and the United Nations weapons inspectors back into the country. A rather better use of two meetings with Saddam Hussein than your own Secretary of State for Defense made of his. In the same opening paragraph, you assert that I was an outspoken supporter of the Hussein regime. This is false. I have brought along here a dossier for all the members of your committee of statements by me as early as the 15th of March 1990, in which I condemn the Saddam Hussein dictatorship in the most withering terms, a stance I have taken since around about the time you were an anti-Vietnam War demonstrator. I was an opponent of Saddam Hussein when British and American governments and businessmen were selling him guns and gas. I used to demonstrate outside the Iraqi embassy when British and American officials were going in and out doing commerce. You will see from the official parliamentary record, Hansard, from the 15th of March 1990 onwards, voluminous evidence that I have a rather better record of opposition to Saddam Hussein than you do and than any member of the British or American governments do. Now, you say in this document, you quote a source, you have the gall to quote a source without ever having asked me if the allegation from the source was true, that I am, quote, the owner of a company which has made substantial profits from trading in Iraqi oil. Senator, I do not own any companies beyond a small company whose entire purpose, whose sole purpose, is to receive the income from my journalistic earnings from my employer, Associated Newspapers in London. I do not own a company that's been trading in Iraqi oil. And you had no business to carry a quotation, utterly unsubstantiated and false, implying otherwise. Now, you have nothing on me, Senator, except my name on lists of names from Iraq, many of which have been drawn up after the installation of your puppet government in Baghdad. If you had any of the letters against me that you had against Zhirinovsky and even Pasqua, they would have been up there in your slideshow for the members of your committee today. You have my name on lists provided to you by the Dulfer inquiry, provided to him by the convicted bank robber and fraudster and con man Ahmed Chalabi, who many people, to their credit in your country, now realize played a decisive role in leading your country into the disaster in Iraq. There were 270 names on that list originally. That's somehow been filleted down to the names you chose to deal with in this committee. Some of the names on that committee included the former secretary to His Holiness Pope John Paul II, the former head of the African National Congress presidential office, and many others who had one defining characteristic in common. They all stood against the policy of sanctions and war, which you vociferously prosecuted and which has led us to this disaster. You quote Mr. Taha Yassin Ramadan. Well, you have something on me. I've never met Mr. Taha Yassin Ramadan. Your subcommittee apparently has. But I do know that he's your prisoner. I believe he's in Abu Ghraib prison. I believe he's facing war crimes charges, punishable by death. In these circumstances, knowing what the world knows about how you treat prisoners in Abu Ghraib prison, in Bagram Air Base, in Guantanamo Bay, including, I may say, British citizens being held in those places, I'm not sure how much credibility anyone would put on anything you managed to get from a prisoner in those circumstances. But you quote 13 words from Taha Yassin Ramadan, whom I have never met. If he said what he said, then he is wrong. And if you had any evidence that I had ever engaged in any actual oil transaction, if you had any evidence that anybody ever gave me any money, it would be before the public and before this commitment today. Because I agreed with your Mr. Greenblatt. Your Mr. Greenblatt was absolutely correct. What counts is not the names on the paper. What counts is where's the money, Senator? Who paid me hundreds of thousands of dollars of money? The answer to that is nobody. And if you had anybody who ever paid me a penny, you would have produced them here today. Now, you refer at length to a company named in these documents as Iredio Petroleum. I say to you under oath here today, I have never heard of this company. I have never met anyone from this company. This company has never paid a penny to me. And I'll tell you something else. I can assure you that Iredio Petroleum has never paid a single penny to the Mariam Appeal campaign. Not a thin dime. I don't know who Iredio Petroleum are, but I dare say if you were to ask them, they would confirm that they have never met me or ever paid me a penny. Whilst I'm on that subject, who is this senior former regime official that you spoke to yesterday? Don't you think I have a right to know? Don't you think the committee and the public have a right to know who this senior former regime official you were quoting against me, interviewed yesterday, actually is? Now, one of the most serious of the mistakes that you have made in this set of documents is, to be frank, such a schoolboy howler as to make a fool of the efforts that you have made. You assert on page 19, not once, but twice, that the documents that you're referring to cover a different period in time from the documents covered by the Daily Telegraph, which were the subject of a libel action won by me in the High Court in England late last year. You state that the Daily Telegraph article cited documents from 1992 and 1993, whilst you are dealing with documents dating from 2001. Senator, the Daily Telegraph's documents date identically to the documents that you are dealing with in your report here. None of the Daily Telegraph's documents dealt with a period of 1992-1993. I had never set foot in Iraq until late in 1993. Never in my life. There could possibly be no documents relating to oil for food matters in 1992-93, for the oil for food scheme did not exist at that time. And yet, you've allocated a full section of this document to claiming that your documents are from a different era to the Daily Telegraph documents, when the opposite is true. Your documents and the Daily Telegraph documents deal with exactly the same period. But perhaps you were confusing the Daily Telegraph action with the Christian Science Monitor. The Christian Science Monitor did indeed publish on its front pages a set of allegations against me, very similar to the ones that your committee have made. They did indeed rely on documents which started in 1992-1993. These documents were unmasked by the Christian Science Monitor themselves as forgeries. Now, the neocon websites and newspapers in which you're such a hero, Senator, were all absolutely cock-a-hoop at the publication of the Christian Science Monitor documents. They were all absolutely convinced of their authenticity. They were all absolutely convinced that these documents showed me receiving $10 million from the Saddam Hussein regime. And they were all lies. In the same week as the Daily Telegraph published their documents against me, the Christian Science Monitor published theirs, which turned out to be forgeries, and the British newspaper Mail on Sunday purchased a third set of documents, which also on forensic examination turned out to be forgeries. So there's nothing fanciful about this. Nothing at all fanciful about it. The existence of forged documents implicating me in commercial activities with the Iraqi regime is a proven fact. It's a proven fact that these forged documents existed and were being circulated amongst right-wing newspapers in Baghdad and around the world in the immediate aftermath of the fall of the Iraqi regime. Now, Senator, I gave my heart and soul to oppose the policy that you promoted. I gave my political life's blood to try to stop the mass killing of Iraqis by the sanctions on Iraq, which killed 1 million Iraqis, most of them children. Most of them died before they even knew that they were Iraqis, but they died for no other reason other than that they were Iraqis, with the misfortune to be born at that time. I gave my heart and soul to stop you committing the disaster that you did commit in invading Iraq. And I told the world that your case for the war was a pack of lies. I told the world that Iraq, contrary to your claims, did not have weapons of mass destruction. I told the world, contrary to your claims, that Iraq had no connection to Al-Qaeda. I told the world, contrary to your claims, that Iraq had no connection to the atrocity on 9/11/2001. I told the world, contrary to your claims, that the Iraqi people would resist a British and American invasion of their country, and that the fall of Baghdad would not be the beginning of the end, but merely the end of the beginning. Senator, in everything I said about Iraq, I turned out to be right, and you turned out to be wrong. And 100,000 people have paid with their lives, 1,600 of them American soldiers, sent to their deaths on a pack of lies, 15,000 of them wounded, many of them disabled forever, on a pack of lies. If the world had listened to Kofi Annan, whose dismissal you demanded, if the world had listened to President Chirac, who you want to paint as some kind of corrupt traitor, if the world had listened to me and the anti-war movement in Britain, we would not be in the disaster that we're in today. Senator, this is the mother of all smokescreens. You are trying to divert attention from the crimes that you supported, from the theft of billions of dollars of Iraq's wealth. Have a look at the real oil for food scandal. Have a look at the 14 months You were in charge of Baghdad the first 14 months when $8.8 billion of Iraq's wealth went missing on your watch. Have a look at Halliburton and the other American corporations that stole not only Iraq's money, but the money of the American taxpayer. Have a look at the oil that you didn't even meter, that you were shipping out of the country and selling, the proceeds of which went who knows where. Have a look at the $800 million you gave to American military commanders to hand out around the country without even counting it or weighing it. Have a look at the real scandal breaking in the newspapers today, revealed in the earlier testimony in this committee, that the biggest sanctions busters were not me or Russian politicians or French politicians. The real sanctions busters were your own companies with the connivance of your own government.
Thank you, Mr. Galloway. Mr. Galloway, can we start by talking about Fawaz Azarkan? Do you know the individual?
I know him very well.
In fact, you were best man at his wedding?
I was.
And at some point in time, he became chair of Miriam's appeal, is that correct?
He did, yeah.
And can you tell me when that occurred?
I think in late 2000 or early 2001.
Before Mr. Zurekat was chair of Miriam's appeal, who had that position?
I was the founding chairman.
Was there somebody in between you and...
Mr. Halford.
And do you recall when he had that position?
I don't.
Mr. Zurekat was a significant contributor to Miriam's appeal, is that correct?
He was the second biggest contributor. The main contributor was Sheikh Zayed, the ruler of the United Arab Emirates, which you've glossed over in your report because it's slightly embarrassing to you. And the third major contributor was the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia, which you've equally glossed over because it's embarrassing to you.
And how much
both of those individuals are your friends.
How much did Mr. Zarakid contribute to Miriam's appeal?
Roughly 375,000 English pounds.
But about $600,000 American?
Well, I don't know the conversion, but it's 375,000 sterling.
If you can, and he was, by the way, Mr. Zarakid was your representative, designated representative for the activity of Miriam's appeal, is that correct?
For the activities of the Miriam appeal, yes.
And when did he get that position?
I think late 2000.
Late 2000. Looking at Exhibit 9, and I think you have the books in front of you.
Okay, there's more to that. It's a 42-minute clip, and it gets to where every single exhibit that they are trying to show him, he is once again showing that there's misinformation, there's fraud, there's forgery, and he just destroys the committee, and they don't know what to say. So they don't say anything. So it's important to realize our Congress and the agencies that support our Congress, that the go-to for information are frequently co-opted. I want to spend the rest of this time mentioning someone that has paid no reputational loss because of the fraud of the Cheney and group of getting us into the Iraq War and other conflicts as well. And that's Halliburton and its offshoot Kellogg-Brown root. And in 2017, they settled for $29 million of fine for accounting violations within the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act in winning lucrative oil field contracts in Angola. In 2015, they were fined $18 million for violating the fair labor standards and wage and hour salaries. In 2009, they paid out $559 million, along with KBR, a unit for multiple counts of government bribery to win oil and gas contracts in Kazakhstan. In 2008, they paid $579 million, found bribing of Nigerian government officials and former military heads of state, and being awarded multi-million-dollar no-bid contracts. And the center of scandal, and Albert Jack Stanley, a longtime Cheney friend, pleaded guilty to violating the Foreign Corrupt Practice Act. In 2007, it was announced that it would move its headquarters and chair and chief executive to Dubai and has no extradition agreements with the United States, meaning any Halliburton executives could not be compelled to return to the United States to testify and stand trial or to serve any sentence relative to any Halliburton activities under investigation. In 2004, it paid $7.5 million settlement for accounting fraud, and KBR, its largest recipient of non-competitive defense contracts in Iraq, has earned $40 billion in profit in a decade, which includes housing and food services, and several dozen smaller fines and settlements, mostly for workplace and health safety, but also for environmental chemical. And understand that this was all on Dick Cheney and that inside the Beltway system of how they all work together and their friends get the contracts and money, and then later they can become a consultant for them or they can become a lobbyist for them. It's just one completely corrupt system. And something else that Dick Cheney did that is, to my knowledge, never been done before in American political history. He managed to become the most powerful vice president in American history, and more powerful, in fact, than the president, because the deal that he would become the vice president was based upon him being able to oversee the military and energy and domestic issues and foreign policy. In effect, all the important positions outside of ceremonial ones that the president normally handles. He wasn't going to be just a showpiece. Now, he then embedded himself in the State Department. He had an office there. The Defense Department, he had an office there. The House of Representatives, he had an office. The CIA had an office. So all of our governmental agencies, Dick Cheney was there, and he then brings in a group, and these are the technocrats. These are the people we called the best and brightest, and Halberstam said that about the Kennedy's group in Washington, the best and brightest. And these people all know each other, and they generally come from the same economic and class backgrounds. Now, once you get these people in positions, they are policymakers. They can run an agency. They decide at the EPA, at the defense, at the energy departments, what policy will be implemented. And these are all friends of and allied with the Dick Cheneys or whoever got them. And the Clintons were notorious for getting thousands of these people in stay-behind positions. So even when these people left office, they would always have a chance to come back. That's why they left so many people in positions of power in Washington, because they believed that they had a right to a dynasty. The most dysfunctional family in American history, the Clintons, the most ruthless ever, the Clintons, would now have a dynasty. You can bet it would have gone from Bill to Hillary to their Chelsea, their daughter. And they already had an example of this with Bush. Bush Sr., then Bush Jr., and then it was going to be Jeb Bush in 2016. So we're not good at dynasties in America, and these people act in this imperial way, that somehow they're entitled to this. And how they get help is they have these stay-behinds in every single department. So no matter where you go in the body politic of Washington, you're going to meet someone who is in a powerful position who can block you from doing anything against these people. Why do you think that right now the former president of Brazil is sitting in a prison and the current president of Brazil, Argentina, could go to prison? All over South America, there's regime change and showing massive endemic corruption in all the different regimes, and now the people are holding these people accountable and putting them in jail. Why is it no American has to ever fear being in a position of power and going to prison? And when you're in that field, if you are found guilty, like Caspar Weinbrenner, you'll be pardoned. Like Bill Clinton pardoned many of his friends, Dan Exeter, who is a big politician or political and business mover and shaker in Arkansas, and his brother, half-brother Billy, he pardoned him. You know, expunged their records. This is how it works. So when we're told, and this is what you got to listen carefully to, when we're told that we got into Iraq based upon faulty intelligence, that's not true. Dick Cheney, with his sidekick Scooter Libby, set up their own CIA operatives and national intelligence operatives and defense operatives, because Cheney's former friend who had hired him, he hired to be his defense secretary, and they worked together to create the intelligence they wanted. And they knew about this character that everyone else, from the Mossad to German intelligence to the CIA, all said he is not credible, he's a liar, wouldn't pass a polygraph test, and his name was Curveball. They created that. Dick Cheney's people did. So then they gave that information to Judith Miller of the New York Times. Miller didn't know she was being played. She was. She then banged the drums for war, and then Cheney and Condoleezza Rice and all the other people in the cabinet, and remember, the cabinet was two. One was Cheney's people, and the other was George Bush's people. But they all had to sing from the same hymnal. You know, we don't want a mushroom cloud, and they are torturing, and they've got weapons. None of this was true. Not a word of it was true. And then they would say, but you see, the New York Times has found that this is true. No, you fed information to the New York Times, and now you're repeating it. And that's what they do all the time. So you see, you're not going to ever stop corruption in Washington because the entire city is corrupt at every level, from the Supreme Court and the federal judges and the senators, the legislators. It's just one giant cesspool. And unfortunate to the people who think, I'm going to go in there with ideals and change it. No, fool, you're going to change nothing. You're just not bright enough to understand that. But you still have people who think, all I have to do is get in there and I will become the, what are you going to become? They will stamp you out so quickly because the entire government is corrupt. The entire system is corrupt. And Dick Cheney should be in prison, along with everyone else in the last four administrations. They should all be serving life in prison for crimes against humanity. But they'll make hundreds of millions of dollars in lecture fees. Their ass will be kissed everywhere they go. And that's the way our system is today. I'm Gary Null. Thank you all for listening. And thank goodness there are people in the world who are willing to go to Washington and just make those people look like the blithering idiots that they are. Good for you, George Galloway. Have a nice day.